I'm here with the heart, the soul, the voice of Three Dog Night, Chuck Negron. Chuck, welcome to Psychobabble. Good to have you here, man.
Psychobabble. You qualify. Now, everyone is familiar with the music. But let's set the table for some of our younger viewers who might not be quite as familiar with the legacy.
50?
Yeah, all right. But Three Dog Night scored 21 consecutive top 40 hits between 1969 and 1975, and to date has sold 85 million records worldwide.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah, that is. How many of you have sold 85 million records? That's incredible, Chuck. You got world famous, world tours, gold records, everything, but success isn't the entire Chuck Negron story. And let me take a quote out of your autobiography. You were a multimillionaire by the time you were 30, and then I traded a plush 5,000 square foot Mediterranean style villa in the Hollywood Hills with a garage full of Mercedes for a corner of an abandoned building in a crime-ridden Los Angeles neighborhood where I slept on a filthy mattress that was found in a vacant lot. I fought to share dull, dirty needles with a collection of lost, hopeless, pathetic junkies who are probably dead by now. That's quite a turn of events for a nice kid from New York who went to college on a basketball scholarship.
Well, it was a book I felt I had to write, concerning the perils of addiction and how one can, one can get into it very innocently. Mm-hmm. Through, experimenting with peers and stuff. And some of us don't get to walk away because we're more predisposed to be more, more obsessive. For me, the story is that 15 years later, I'm coming up on 15 years clean and sober, and my life is changed. I have a 5-year-old, a 12-year-old have never seen me, drunk or loaded, and my life has been blessed because of the recovery I found.
The turning point came in 1991 at a place called Cry Help.
Yes, a long-term rehab. When I was in Three Dog Night, I was very young, and I just finished playing college basketball, and so I was kind of in training for a drug addict. I was in great shape. It took me quite a while because being a young man and the progression of the disease to social using until, this all-out addiction took a long time. But finally, I had probably a 10-year bottom where my life was really over, and was really blessed to be able to go on the Cry Help September 17th, 1991, and that's when my life changed. And there is hope for people out there. There is recovery.
Absolutely. If anyone, it's a cliche that I should have been dead by now, but if anyone should have been dead by now, some of your adventures and misadventures.
The sad thing, about that, I know some, you're really rolling the dice. I know a lot of just normal people use recreationally, and they die. The drugs out there, and then addicts go on and on and on and on, and then of course some die. So you don't know, who's gonna die, who's not. I mean, a lot of my peers, to me, Jimi Hendrix wasn't a drug addict. He was a guy that used socially, and once in a while got a little too high, but.
You rubbed elbows with all those guys, Jimmy.
Yeah, well, we all played together. Morrison, I knew by the time we really hit Morrison, as far as an entertainer's days were over. Mm-hmm. Of course, he was an icon and a celebrity, but he was a very interesting thing to watch because he went from probably the most powerful front man in the business to, an overweight guy with a beard and really lost.
Drunk.
And it was like, wow, that's scary. How does that happen? And then, of course, died. And then there's so many. Ron Bonham, drank himself to death.
Three Dog Night wasn't, to the public eye anyway, wasn't really lumped in with all those guys. You guys weren't viewed as a druggy band like the Stones or the Doors. You guys were kind of America's band. You rode a float in the Rose Bowl parade in 1972.
We were a real mainstream band, and we weren't that underground band. The band started out that way, but then just the amount of success, mm-hmm. you know, throws you on AM radio, and it was a gift. You know, the interesting thing that people don't really know is, you know, the bands that were perceived as hipper bands were asking us how to get a top 40 record.
Right, right.
You know, I mean, they're getting played on FM, but they were, you know, one or two albums were getting on the charts, but they really weren't, you know, selling, you know, big venues, of course, except for the very big bands. Anyway, it was an interesting time, and the shame of it is it wasn't a lesson for kids today that, you know, some of us don't get to walk away from drug use.
I understand you were close to participating in an intervention with Kurt Cobain shortly before he died.
Well, actually, for years I've been hesitant to talk about that, but since he has passed, you know, I have mentioned it. Yeah, I was part of a group called MAP, Musicians Assistance Program, which was started to help musicians in need, and actually specifically the musician behind the scene that wasn't the star that, you know, needed the funding, and that was our initial goal. Of course, became big, and we ended up handling a lot of celebrities because I could go in and talk to them, or I don't want to mention names, but a lot of other celebrities could go one-on-one with these guys. And yeah, they called me to go in and see him. He was going to want to talk to me, and he left. He left, and a couple of days later, killed himself. So it's a very overwhelming thing, you know. And I didn't get to speak to him, so I don't know. But I understand the feeling where you're a drug addict, you're hooked like a research monkey. But you say, hey, listen, you know, if I have a hit record, I'll stop. You have a hit record. Well, if my album goes platinum, well, if I have a child, I'll stop. And then all of a sudden, you realize you have everything you want, and you can't stop, and your life is hell. And then other things come in, depression and all sorts, because these chemicals cause a lot of other things. And next thing you know, your life isn't worth anything to you. And so I could see where someone would take their own life, you know, because, you know, it's kind of a permanent solution to a temporary problem. It's very sad.
And coming from where you come from, you have a unique perspective and an ability to reach out to these people.
Yeah, I think the asset, you know, I have, I mean, for me, to them, my calling card was 85, 90 million records sold, and, you know, all the success. I know that's what the people at MAP, you know, would say. But my calling card to them was, they knew I was a hardcore junkie. They knew, you know, that I had hepatitis A, B, and C, and that my life was over, and you know, I have one lung, and I wasn't going to make it, and I made it.
Right.
So, I gave them hope. Before Rick James died, he called me, and I went to see him in the hospital, and he was so sick, and you know, he actually said to me, you know, as long as I don't get as bad as you, and I went, Rick, you're worse. I said, you can't even talk. His lungs were really bad. And we had similar physical problems, emphysema. And he had, I don't know if he was diagnosed with emphysema. He sounded like he had it, and he was terrible. You know, I'm not a doctor, but he had lung stuff. And I told him he was gonna die if he didn't stop. And then when he went home, his roommate would call me and ask me to come by. Then he passed away.
If you could share, I heard you share a story one time about trying to con your mother while you were in the throes of addiction. Do you remember that?
Well, actually, what it was I had 3 years clean, and my mother finally agreed to see, you know, welcomed me to come visit her, and I went to visit her. And my mother is kind of a woman that kind of has to tell you, you know, what she's thinking. So, we were just in the kitchen. And, you know, she just out of nowhere, you know what the camel was, destroy, you know what it was, I mean, you know what it was, you lied, you, and I said, well, Mommy, I know I lied. She said, but no, you were telling me a story, and you were lying right in my face. And I said, I'm sorry. She said, no, hear me, you were lying right in my face. And I said, son, you're lying right in my face. And you said, yeah, Mom, but hear me out.
Shit. Only an addict can understand that. But your story, if nothing, is a story of redemption. I mean, the fact that you're alive, you're singing, you did a great show tonight, man. Your career, you're a testament to the fact that no one is hopeless. I mean, they're really, I mean, it's a spiritual recovery.
No, there is faith, with faith. Mm-hmm. And at some point, what you have to do is turn your life over to the care of someone else just because you're too insane. The only rational thing, and sometimes is locked up. I was going to prison or going to cry help. That's the only reason I was in there. Unfortunately, I stayed in there long enough to some sanity. After I withdrew from all the drugs, a clarity started happening where I started realizing, you know what, I feel okay today. You know, and then with a lot of support and from the staff and people, I started realizing that I might be able to do this. And then just with a faith that these people really could show me the way, in fact, were loving me and nurturing me in spite of the nasty person I had become. Mm-hmm. Because I was almost 50 years old and had nothing, and was kind of pissed off about it, you know, as opposed to, you know, looking at myself, I blamed everyone else.
And this is after having everything.
Yeah, everything. And that's you know, I mean, as a friend told me once, a very naive statement, the way he said, he said, man, people used to jump off of buildings because they lost their money like you.
What are you suggesting?
In the stock market, they were killing themselves, didn't lose near as much money as you. And, I went, what a bright guy.
Well, I know you're a busy man. Any final words for the people out here who have followed you for a number of years?
Anyone in trouble, in any kind of trouble, there is so much help for all of us out there. You know, we just have to seek it and kind of find a faith that with help we can get help. But when we're in trouble, it's very hard for us to help ourselves. And don't I look good?
You look marvelous. Chuck Negron, thank you very much.